Put yourself in the shoes of another. You're an eBay seller. You've just made a $4,000 sale, potentially the biggest sale of your life. You go through the pains of packaging it securely, making sure all the fragile bits won't break in transportation. It's $4,000 after all. What will you use that money on? A vacation? Pay off bills? A down payment? You ship it out, you wait a few days, and you find out it was destroyed in transit. Destroyed, broken, useless, $4,000 down the drain. Well, today's video, we're talking about that. Our good friend Josh, aka Harry Tornado, interviewed a seller who, from the title, I haven't watched the video yet, lost $4,000 because UPS destroyed their product. Let's watch it.
The most expensive thing I've personally ever sold on eBay was a pair of Bowflex adjustable weight dumbbells. I sold them in April of 2000.
Those were crazy. Back then, you could sell pretty much anything exercise related for like 10 times what it cost originally.
And 20 at the height of the pandemic for $1,150 plus shipping. I did pay to add some extra insurance to them because it was a very expensive package. And fortunately, they arrived safely, no issues at all. But unfortunately, the same thing cannot be said for my friend Amy and one of the most expensive items she's ever sold on eBay. Today, I want to share with you her story about how UPS broke her $4,000
Yikes, that is like my worst nightmare.
So all I know about you is that I follow you on Instagram. I don't remember where that came about. I think it was just like one of those reseller accounts that I stumbled upon, and then I just enjoy the content you post. You don't post a ton on there, but a couple months ago, you posted a really cool find that you bought, I think, at an auction, and I'll let you take it away and kind of explain where you got it and what the item was.
Sure. So about 2 years ago, I was actually following a bunch of live auctions online. I use AuctionZip, and I'm really into Disney stuff, so I like to pick up Disney and sell Disney and go to Disney. So yeah, it was a Disney collector in New York City.
That's another thing that a lot of people who are new to reselling don't think of is local auctions. I've talked about local auctions for years. I love going to local auctions, buying, selling at local auctions. A great way to move collections of things, like she bought, it sounds like, to sell items that are too big to ship or too difficult to ship or too delicate to ship, or like collections of cards that are low value and are going to cost a lot to ship. Local auctions are really slept on because there's not like an interactive aspect to it, so you don't see a lot of YouTube content about it.
I'm from Connecticut, so it was maybe an hour and a half drive, so it was pretty close. Yeah. So they had a bunch of people, they know the WDCC collection. They're like the Disney figures. So I picked up a bunch of those, and then they had this huge Snow White piece. And nobody was really bidding on it, and I looked it up online, and I couldn't really find anything. It had a number that I think it was.
Anything numbered usually skyrockets the value. I had an opportunity to buy some fish posters a few weeks ago, Fish Like the Band. And I saw online that numbered posters were going for about $150 bucks. But as I began to examine these posters that I was had the chance to buy, they were just reprints, not original.
Like 125 out of 255 or something. So I knew it was a rare piece. I looked up the artist really quick. It was an Italian artist, and I just put a bid in. I won it for $650. There is a...
Just to clarify, that's $650, not $6.50.
Yeah. $650 is an 18% buyer's fee.
That's how a lot of these local auctions or online in-person auctions work, is there's a buyer's fee. So I'm sure she'll explain it in a second, but basically you're paying the cost you're bidding plus usually 15 or 18%, and that goes to facilitate the auction. Just the auction house usually keeps that.
I don't pay tax because it's under my LLC. Yeah. And then that was it. I think I picked up maybe 30 other smaller items. It was one of my bigger purchases. I spent almost $2,000 at that auction.
On everything, all 31 items together.
Oh yeah. Yep.
So I'm gonna put a picture of the item on the screen here, what we're talking about. When I saw it on Instagram, I didn't realize how big it was. Like, I was like, oh, this is like, you know, a little 12-inch wide or 12-inch tall, but this thing was like 2 feet wide, right?
Wow. That is huge. I really, this is why I avoid shipping those giant things. The biggest thing I've ever shipped was a national park sign. Made a video on it from like 2018. Old video. Everything else that's that big, I sell locally because you just can't control so much that goes on in the shipping process.
It's made of ceramic. It was, I think, 27 pounds. It's 35 inches. It's pretty tall. It was big.
Yeah. So, I mean, that was a big risk. I mean, you're paying $650 or something.
Wow.
Knowing that you're probably going to have to sell that online and ship it to somebody. So did you think about that like in depth before you bought it? Or did you maybe have the possibility that you would sell it local? Or what was like your thought process going into it?
Yeah, I definitely wanted to sell it local.
I don't think I would have done this. $650 into $4,000 on eBay. For collectibles, you're only paying that 12% or 12.9% up to $2,500. So the last $1,500 was at a lower rate. I think it's only 2%. I don't remember. I sold a Rolex for over $7,000 about a month ago, and I did not pay that full 12% fee on the entire value of the Rolex. So there, it's like a tiered rate. So probably she's paying about $300 total in eBay fees, give or take $20, depending on what she's actually paying. I'm not really sure what her fee is. It could be her store has a different fee than a basic store or a starter store, but around $300.
Looked up how much it would ship. I figured it'd be about $500 to ship.
$500 to ship.
But I had a bunch of people reach out to me too that they wanted me to drive like half.
Jeez. Well, I guess that's the thing too about like Disney people is they're so into it that they would drive halfway across the country. I mean, that's going to be 2 days of driving and about $800 in gas. So I probably delivery is not an option. But if you're near New York City, which sounds like she is, that's not a crazy idea.
Halfway across the country to meet them, or I figured someone in New York may want it, or I live in like Connecticut, New England. I figured there's some collectors up here, but yeah. People who reached out were from California, Florida.
Yeah. All the big stuff always goes to the opposite side of the country.
Yeah. One guy actually reached out to me. He had the same unit, and my statue had the entire forest, and the rest of them didn't. So the artist stopped making that. So he said there was only actually a handful of units like mine that he also had, which, you know, piqued my. He didn't want to buy it. He was just informing me of the history.
How rare it was.
Art, yeah. Yeah.
That's awesome. So you got it listed on eBay, I assume?
Yep.
eBay. Yeah. So how long was it listed before it sold?
It was listed for two years.
I want to know, would you spend $650 to get $4,000? We'll call it. We'll say a $3,000, no, because shipping. We'll say a $2,500 profit. Would you take $650 into $2,500 profit in 2 years? I'm curious. Let me know in the comments.
2 years. Okay. So it took a while. So big investment. Took a while to sell, but you got the notification that it sold for how much money?
$4,000.
$4,000. That's crazy. So obviously you were super excited for that sale, but when did the excitement from the sales, or maybe it never did, but did the excitement wear off when you realized that you did have to ship this item?
I was super excited. I took off the day of work to figure out how to ship it. You know, I came back to my office. I cleaned all the dust off of it. I was super scared to get it into my car, to pick it up and just to move it. But I was stressed, but I was super happy.
Yeah. I mean, that's amazing. $650 and the $4,000. That is an impressive flip. So was it 4,000 plus shipping or 4,000 free shipping?
That was free shipping.
Okay.
Here's a learning moment. When you have a one of one item, you don't have to do free shipping. You don't have to. Because the oftentimes you're going to do free shipping to get the top search result or to have better search placement or whatever. But if it's a one of one item, like she said, it's the only one that has the trees. I do this all the time with lower value stuff. You can charge shipping because if the person wants it, they want it. And in this case, it'd be $500 extra.
So when you wanted to ship this, obviously, I think on Instagram you said it was kind of difficult to find a carrier that would insure it. I think USPS was like had some limits or whatever, and FedEx was super expensive. There was a private shipping company that wanted like $900 to ship it.
Yep. So I called FedEx first. They would only insure art up to $1,000. Mm-hmm. I couldn't add on. I couldn't do anything. And then I called a private shipper. They wanted $800 and they wouldn't move it fast. And unfortunately I had a small handling time on it. So I called UPS. They quoted me just over $300, but they would insure up to, I think, $20,000. And they told me.
I have not seen that. I have not seen UPS insuring up to $20,000. I recently, when I had to ship that Rolex to the authenticator, UPS would only insure up to $2,500. And then I had to get supplemental insurance through like UPIC, I think, for the additional $5,000. So maybe that's an eBay thing. Maybe it's a watch thing. I don't know. But I could not get $20,000 from UPS insurance. Actually, I'm wrong. It was $2,500 for the post office, and then FedEx and UPS would insure for up to $5,000. And then I had to get the additional $2,200 insurance from a third-party provider.
Guaranteed. Make sure you bring it in. I couldn't obviously buy it through my eBay account.
Yeah.
So they did the shipping, they did the packing. I paid them directly for the payment of the boxes and everything, and they promised I would be fully insured.
That's all. The only time I've ever done that, I had a guitar and I didn't have a box.
Maybe that's
for
a special thing. Like if you have them package it, you can have additional insurance. I don't know.
And I was like, I'll just take it to UPS. They offered the ship service thing, and the guitar sold for like $300 or something. And the box and shipping to like Texas from South Carolina, Texas was going to be like $250, like almost as much as the guitar cost. I'm like, that's crazy. And I said, how much just for the box? Like I can ship it myself. And they wanted like $50 just for the box. So I would say the only time I would recommend people watching this video to go to UPS and have them pack and ship something for you is in a case like yours, where it's a very rare item, very expensive, and you just want to take all the risk.
There's entire stores, they're called like pack mail around here, that offer better rates on packaging and shipping than the UPS store does. Just heads up.
Having that guarantee, like they're going to pack it, they're going to ship it, they're going to insure it in case it breaks. I think that's well worth the $300 or so that you paid to ship it. So.
Oh, yeah.
This is also why a lot of sellers will sell on Mercari, for example, because Mercari has an option for UPS pack and ship, and it's like $40 or $20, but it ends up being cheaper in some cases than going into the store yourself.
Now we get into the good part. So what? I'll let you take it away from here. You shipped it off. How many days before you got it?
Okay, we're 7 minutes in. Cutting to the chase. Let's hear about the tragedy. Let's go.
Yep, so I shipped it. The guy had contacted me, so did you ship it? Can I have the tracking number?
That's such a terrible wait.
It was supposed to take about 3 to 5 days ground. Mm-hmm. I watched it. He actually.
We've all been there. You sell something expensive, and you like every day you want to see like where is it? How's it doing? How are things going? Can I have my money? Can I, you know, because buyers have up to 30 days on eBay to say it's broken or not as described, and you cannot have returns on whatever. But buyers can always kind of screw you over if they really want to. So it can be very stressful on these high value purchases.
I owned a flower shop, so I was kind of nervous with like a commercial front house, but it was there fine. He signed it. He told me he signed for it. And then he opened it and sent me pictures and said,
yeah, she knows her stuff. She definitely knows what to look out for and how to do things. And yeah, anytime you're sending to a commercial warehouse, they're going to be having so many other packages that you can't really guarantee that once they receive it, it's going to be, I bet that this video ends in the person like taking it out wrong or being crushed by a pallet of begonias. I don't know.
It was destroyed. So it was totally shattered and he was really upset.
It wasn't just like one of the little birds broke off. It was like completely just in shambles.
It looks like it
totally shattered.
The forest fell.
$4,000. Totally shattered.
The dwarves.
If you have a picture of that, definitely send it to me through Instagram. I'll put it in the video here. But
it hurts. I have secondhand pain from this.
So you just sold this $4,000 item that you've had for 2 years. You go through all these hoops to ship it and insure it properly, and then it arrives broken. So what do you do now?
So and then the heartbreak. Send me all the pictures. He was obviously upset. He wouldn't send me pictures of the box. I'm like, I need it for insurance reasons. You know, he's like, give me my money. He filed, you know, very quickly with PayPal and with eBay.
Why wouldn't you do that? All right. Okay. Scam alert. When they don't send you pictures of the box, like, why wouldn't you do that? Oh, I broke the box down. Okay. You're not just hurrying away the evidence on a $4,000 purchase. That reeks of BS.
Mm-hmm. I was, you know, didn't want my account to get, you know, dinged. So I refunded him knowing that I had insurance. But yeah. That's where the next.
Well, that's pretty scary. Like giving him the refund. I mean,
What a jackass. The people who file disputes before you have a chance to respond or file chargeback claims, like, those people do not deserve to have the right to use these tools. You have to escalate the way it's meant to be escalated. Otherwise, you're going to screw over the seller. You're going to screw him over. If he did a chargeback to her, she could lose her account over something that she, again, she's going to refund him. It just is. I'm sure that now it's a better process, but back in like 2016, people would just charge back whenever they wanted to. It was insane.
I guess your insurance wasn't purchased through eBay. It was through UPS directly. So that was placing a lot of trust in UPS to actually go through and pay the insurance claim, because if they didn't pay it, you're out the $4,000 or the $4,650 right now.
Right. So, okay. That's what was.
I've never had an issue with UPS or FedEx refunding for an insurance. I've had a lot of problem with the post office waiting months and months to refund me and asking for asinine details. But FedEx and UPS do a very good job and have great customer service. Go figure.
First mistake. I rushed through it, and I just wanted to please him and not get my account, you know, hurt by him. So
yeah, just one of those eBay buyers that, I mean, I kind of don't blame him. Like, if I buy something for $4,000 and it arrives broken, like, I guess I'll be upset. But also, I think it's important for people to, like, be willing to communicate. Like, if you're answering,
I blame him.
Explaining things.
Like, of course, like Josh doesn't blame him.
Kind of.
I blame him.
Like, not wanting to send photos of the box and everything. But
and then
you refunded him. And then
if you're not sending pictures of the box,
so
they're not
he
being helpful.
Communicating with me after I went to UPS. And I was like, you know, I went to the UPS myself. I talked to the manager, like, what do I do? This guy, you know, he's not cooperating. They needed him to
scam alert.
Respect it. And he was not allowing that. So I talked to the manager. He, you know, I see him every day. So he said, I'll handle it. I'll talk to him. I gave him his number. And
refund the buyer.
So he never let UPS complete their claim there. And I'm not sure what happened behind the scenes, but it took a very long time. I followed up with UPS corporate.
Wait, when you said very long time, what are we talking about? Like a week?
I know what's happening. He broke it by himself. It wasn't broken by UPS, and he's playing dumb or avoiding contact to delay this conclusion on their investigation.
Almost a month and a half.
Month and a half. Okay. So about 6 weeks.
And they told me originally.
The whole process of like UPS contacting him and him shipping it back and all this stuff is going on.
Oh, I feel so bad for her.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh.
So,
you know what? You know, I was saying, would you wait 2 years to make $2,500? How about you do wait 2 years and then this happens and all that waiting and all that investment, and all that excitement, and everything is just drained from you. Oh, God, I feel bad for her.
Since I purchased it through the store, it was on the store's name. So the insurance was going to be paid to the store.
This guy's a jackass. Show us his name. We can all block him.
I had talked to UPS myself saying, what's taking so long? They originally told me like 5 days. They have proof. They had the pictures. They had my invoice from eBay, you know, showing exactly how much we paid.
Good luck with that.
I fully insured it for. And they just kept reassuring me, you know, you're 100% all set. You were insured and you'll get the money. And eventually the owner was like, I don't know what's taking so long. He wrote me a check.
The biggest UPS insurance claim I've ever had was $375. I sold a camcorder to a guy in Toronto before COVID, like all the lockdowns and shit. And then as it was in, the border got shut down. So it was just like stuck in customs. So I shipped it out. I bought additional insurance and all that stuff. Liability insurance or whatever it's called, incidental insurance, through UPS, and I got a check in a week. it was not a big deal at all, but it wasn't $4,000. It was, you know, a tenth of that.
$4,000. And
Wait, why'd he do that?
I'm not sure. I don't know if there was some fees.
He just had some extra dollars laying around. He's like, I feel bad. Just take it.
That's good.
It was like 4,100
something. 4,200 something.
So not like an extra $5. It's like an extra $200 or so.
Yeah. I don't know if it was maybe partial for the shipping or maybe, I don't know.
Maybe they insured for the sales tax amount too.
So you actually ended up making a little bit more money this way.
Forever the optimist, Josh.
You actually arrived in one piece.
I made way more because I didn't have to pay eBay fees.
Well, I'm glad it all worked out.
The mental anguish and all the legwork had to do had some monetary value. But I thought when I saw this on your Instagram, this was a couple months ago, and I was like, I really want to talk to her about this whole process because most things we sell aren't expensive enough to even worry with insurance. Like if we sell something for over $250 or so, we'll ship it through Pirate.
I'm buying insurance on everything over $50 if it's a collectible, and if it's not a collectible, over $100. So the reason I say over $50 is because generally my collectibles are small, so I'm buying first class mail or medium mail, but everything else I just use priority mail's $100 insurance. And then if we're in like the 150 range, 200 range, then I'll probably buy some additional insurance on pirate ship. I don't buy insurance through eBay. It costs more, a little bit more. You can get a better deal on pirate ship, and that's what Josh is going to say, I think.
Buy their insurance because they're typically a little bit easier to work with than UPS or USPS. But an item like this, like I wouldn't know what to do. And I'm sure most people watching this video right now wouldn't know what to do either. So having you come on and share the story,
it's cheaper too.
It helps me understand like how something like this works. I don't know if I'm ever going to find something that I could sell for $4,000.
And we're going to end it right there. You can watch the whole video if you want. I don't want to just show his content, you know, line for line or whatever. Interesting story. I think that there are things that I may have done differently. Probably not. The only thing I may have done differently is shipped it myself, just to be totally sure. But that might not have allowed me to get that $20,000 insurance from UPS, and I would have had to buy additional insurance through, I think it's UPIC. I'm pretty sure it's called that. Everything else, though, sounds like she did it exactly right. She knows what she's doing, obviously. I mean, she's probably one of the more advanced level Disney resellers or collectors you're going to see online. Great for Josh for highlighting this. I like to talk about it. Glad he made the video. Any questions you have about this process, ask them below and I'll answer them. Thanks for watching, guys. Appreciate your support, and I'll see you guys next week.